हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम एस के निगम, पीजीटी केमिस्ट्री, केंद्रीय विद्यालय. वेलकम टू माय चैनल. टुडे इन दिस सेशन आई एम गोइंग टू जस्ट सॉल्व द इंटेक्स क्वेश्चन ऑफ द चैप्टर नंबर 1, द सॉलिड स्टेट. सो दिस इज चैप्टर नंबर 1, द सॉलिड स्टेट, एंड आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस क्वेश्चंस ऑफ इंटेक्स. So let us discuss the first question. Why are solids rigid? Solids are rigid because in the case of solid, the intermolecular force of attraction is very strong, and the intermolecular spaces is negligible. So this is the reason the intermolecular force of attraction is very high. That's why it is very rigid. And if you want to just apply any kind of force, because intermolecular spaces is negligible, it cannot be compressed, or it cannot just D-shape like this. Okay, next 1.2. Why do solids have a definite volume? Again, the reason will be same. Because of strong intermolecular force of attraction and the negligible intermolecular spaces. As if the intermolecular force of attraction is very strong, then if you are trying to increase the volume, the molecules will not get far apart from each other, because the reason was higher intermolecular force of attraction. Next, they classify the following as amorphous or crystalline solid: polyurethane, naphthalene, benzoic acid, teflon, potassium nitrate, cellophane, polyvinyl chloride, fiberglass, and copper. So as I discussed earlier in my some videos, all the polymers come under the category of amorphous solid. So polyurethane is a polymer, polyurethane, then teflon, then cellophane, then polyvinyl chloride, and fiberglass. All these are the amorphous solid, and rest are the crystalline solid: naphthalene, benzoic acid, then potassium nitrate, then copper. All these are the crystalline solid. Now, question number 1.4. Why is glass considered a super cool liquid? Why is glass considered as a super cool liquid? Because glass is an amorphous solid. An amorphous solid is a kind of pseudo solid, and because of this, if you are just increasing the temperature of that glass, it gets melted over a range of temperature, and this is the reason it is considered as super cool liquid. Now, 1.5, refractive index of a solid is observed to have the same value along all the direction. Comment on the nature of this solid. Would it show cleavage property? So refractive index depends on the bulk of the matter, and if you are moving along the solid and the refractive index remains same along all the direction, it means it is talking about the isotropic property. So isotropic property is shown by the amorphous solid. That's why the nature of the solid is amorphous. Would it show the cleavage property? No, it will not show any cleavage property, because the arrangement is not in ordered manner. Therefore, if you will cut the solid with the help of a sharp edge tool, it will not give a smooth surface, it will give an irregular surface. So next question, 1.6, question number 1.6, classify the following solid in different categories based on the nature of the intermolecular forces operating in them. So on the basis of the force of attraction acting between the particles, classify all these solids into different categories. So like this, molecular solid, anionic solid, metallic solid, covalent solid. These are the forces present between the molecular solid: dispersion or London force present in non-polar molecular solid, dipole-dipole interaction present between polar molecular solid, hydrogen bonding between hydrogen bonded molecular solid, Coulombic or electrostatic attraction between anionic solids, then metallic bonding in metallic solid, covalent bonding, covalent or network solids like this, and amorphous solid. You are very well aware about all these are the type of crystalline solid. So potassium sulfate, then tin, all these just talking about the potassium sulfate is a kind of ionic compound, that's why it is a kind of ionic solid. Tin is a metal, that's a metallic solid. Benzene is a kind of molecule, that is why it is molecular solid. Urea is also a kind of molecular solid. Ammonia is a kind of molecular solid. And then water is also a kind of molecule, that's why it is also a molecular solid. Zinc sulfide is an ionic compound, that's why ionic solid. Graphite is a covalent or network solid. Rubidium is a metal, that's why metallic solid. Argon is a inert gas, monatomic gas, that's why it is a kind of molecular solid. Silicon carbide is a covalent compound, that's why it is a kind of covalent or network solid. All the examples are written here. Next, 1.8, anisic solids conduct electricity in molten state but not in solid state. So explain why. So in the case of anisic solid, the ions are there, but when it is in solid state, ions are not free. When ions are not free, 1.8, anisic solid conduct electricity in molten state but not in solid state. Explain, because anisic solids in solid state, the ions are not free, that's why it cannot conduct electricity, whereas in the molten state, the ions get free and it conduct electricity. Sorry, I left 1.7. So 1.7, solid A is a very hard electrical insulator in solid as well as in molten state and melts at extremely high temperature. What type of solid is it? So the solid A is very hard. So very hard substances, very hard substances are either ionic or metallic or covalent. Okay, then they are insulator in solid as well as in molten state. So ionic solids, they are not ionic solids, because ionic solids are conducted in the molten state, and they are also not the metallic solid, because metallic solids are conducted in both this condition, solid as well as molten state. So the answer becomes covalent solid. So the answer of this 1.7 question is covalent solid, because they are not insulated, they are insulated in solid as well as in the molten state, and also they are very hard. Clear? Now question 1.9, what type of solids are electrical conductors, malleable and ductile? It is very clear, this question is talking about the metallic solid, because they are electric conductor, they are malleable also, they are ductile also. Okay, clear? Now next question 1.10. Question number 1.10, give the significance of lattice point. Lattice point is actually, it is the position, it represents the position of the constant particles present in a unit cell, or you can say the any crystal lattice. Now name the parameters that characterize a unit cell. There are basically two kind of the parameter. One is the dimension, that is the edge length A, B and C, and another is the angle between the edges, that is alpha, beta and gamma. Clear? Now next is distinguish between hexagonal and monoclinic unit cell. So it is mentioned in this table, a hexagonal unit cell, the edge length A is equal to B but B does not equal to C, whereas in the case of monoclinic unit cell, A does not equal to B and B does not equal to C. That's why this is the difference of edge length, and the angle between the edges, alpha beta in the case of hexagonal unit cell, alpha beta is equal to 90 degree and gamma is of 120 degree, and in the case of monoclinic, alpha is equal to gamma is equal to 90 degree and beta does not equal to 90 degree. So these two are the basic differences, and it is also clearly represented in these diagram. This is the example, this is the diagram of hexagonal unit cell and this is the diagram of monoclinic unit cell. So this is the difference of hexagonal unit cell and the monoclinic unit cell. Now next is the face centered and end centered unit cell. So as the name indicates, face centered means along with the corner of the unit cell, there are the molecules which are present at the center of the face, and end centered unit cells are those unit cells in which along with the corner of the unit cell, two opposite faces have the molecules at the centers. Okay, so in the case of face center, all the six faces are all the centers of the six faces are covered by the constant particles, and in the case of end center, two opposite faces centers are occupied, and it is clearly be shown in this example. So this is the end center, two opposite faces, it may be these, maybe, or two, these two, or these two, or front or back, and this is the example of face center. All the center of the faces, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So this is the difference of face centered and the end centered unit cell. Now explain how much portion of an atom located corner and body center of a unit cell is a part of its neighboring unit cell. So in the case of corner, so every unit, the corner of the unit cell is shared by 8 different unit cells. Therefore, the portion shared by a particular unit cell is 1 upon 8 only. Clear? And when you are talking about the body centered unit of a cubic unit cell, so at the center of the body, that particle is not shared by any other unit cell, because it is shared by, it is present at the center of the particular unit cell, it is not shared by any other molecule. So the answer is no part. Clear? Now next heading. So the next one is question number 1.14. question number 1.14. What is the two-dimensional coordination number of a molecule in a square closed packed layer? So what is the two-dimensional coordination number of a molecule in a square closed packed layer? So in closed packing in two dimension, the diagram is like this. This is the diagram of square closed packing of in two dimension, and coordination number is the total number of neighboring atoms which are in direct contact with the particular atom. So for example, if you are considering this molecule or any molecule in this diagram, so you will see the four molecules, 1, 2, 3, 4, there are four molecules which are in direct contact with the particular atom. Therefore, the coordination number in the case of a square closed packing in two dimension is 4. Clear? And the next question, is 1.15. In 1.15, a compound form hexagonal closed packed structure. What is the total number of whites in 0.5 mole of it? How many of these are tetrahedral whites? So the question is asking if the total number of particle is 0.5 mole. So it is question number 1.15. Total number of particles is equal to 0.5 mole. Okay, so therefore number of tetrahedral whites is equal to 2 into 0.5 mole, because the total tetrahedral white is equal to 2n. If the number of particle in a unit cell is n, so the number of tetrahedral white is 2n. Therefore, if that particle is 0.5 mole, then the number of tetrahedral white is 2 into 0.5, means it is 1 mole. And when it will be converted into number, then it is 6.022 into 10 to the power 23. So this is the number of tetrahedral whites. Okay, and the second part is total number of whites. How many total number of whites? So there are two kind of the whites, tetrahedral and octahedral whites. And tetrahedral white is twice of the number of particles, but octahedral white is exactly same in as the number of the particles are there. So it is 0.5 mole because the number of particles is 0.5. Therefore, the octahedral whites are also 0.5, and it is equal to 0.5 into 6.022 into 10 to the power 23. That is, it is equal to 3.011 into 10 to the power 23 octahedral whites. So the next part of the question is total number of whites. So total number of whites is 1.0 tetrahedral white and 0.5 mole octahedral white, means it is equal to 1.5 mole, means it is equal to 9.033 into 10 to the power 23 whites are there. So this is the answer of question 1.15. Clear? Now next question, question number 16, 1.16. A compound is formed by two element M and N. The element N form CCP and an atom of M occupy 1/3 of the tetrahedral whites. What is the formula of the compound? So I solve this question in very easy manner. For example, the element N form CCP. So let the number of N element is equal to X, because the question is telling that the element N forms CCP. Therefore, if number of particles of N element is X and M occupy 1/3 of tetrahedral white, therefore number of tetrahedral white is equal to 2X, and number of M element, because M element is occupying 1/3 of tetrahedral white, so it is 1/3 of 2X, means 2X by 3. Therefore, the ratio of the element, ratio of the elements M and N, M is 2x by 3 and N is X. So X cancel out and it become 2:3, means the formula become, and the formula is M2N3. So this is the answer. Okay, M2N3 is the answer. Now next is, which of the following lattices has the highest packing efficiency? Simple cubic, body-centered, hexagonal, closed-packed lattice. So simple cubic has 52.4%, body-centered 68%, hexagonal closed-packed lattice is 74%. The answer is obviously clear. It is 74%. Now question 1.18, an element with molar mass this 2.7 into 10 power minus 2 kilogram per mole form a cubic unit cell with edge length 405 picometer. If its density is 2.7 into 10 power 3 kilogram per meter cube, what is the nature of the cubic unit cell? So the question is very simple. You have to only just take the formula D is equal to ZM upon A cube NA, where D is the density of the solid, Z is the nature of the unit cell. Means it is, if it is simple cubic, then it is 1. Then if it is BCC body centered, so it is 2. If it is face centered, so it is 4. And M is the molar mass of the solid or the atom. And A is the edge length. And NA is the Avogadro's number. Okay. So in this question, all the values are given here. Density is 2.7 into 10 to the power 3 kilogram per cubic meter. It is equal to, you have to find out the Z, because the question is what is the nature of the cubic unit cell. So you have to find Z into M is also given, 2.7 into 10 to the power minus 2 kilogram per mole divided by 405 picometer. Then it is 10 to the power minus 10 meter. 1 picometer is equal to 10 to the power minus 10 meter, and it is raised to the power 3, and 6.022 into 10 to the power 23. And you have to solve it for Z. After solving it for the Z, it is equal to 4 when you will calculate it. So the nature of the solid is FCC, or you can say it is CCP, face centered cubic unit cell, or cubic closed packing. Take it. Clear? It is clear. Our next question. The question number 1.19. What type of defects can arise when a solid is heated? So when solid is heated, obviously the particles will get energy and they start moving from their own position. Therefore, the kind of defect arises is vacancy defect. Which physical property is affected by it, and in what way? So if vacancy defect arises, it means that there is the loss of particles, and if the loss of particles are there, it means the density get decreases. Clear? So what type of stoichiometric defect is shown by ZNS? ZNS is a kind of solid which show the Frankel defect. AGBR is this kind of substance which show both the kind of defect, Frankel and the Schottky. It is the common example in both the cases. Now next is explain how vacancies are introduced in an ionic solid when a cation of higher valence is added as an impurity in it. So it is very clearly discussed in the chapter that if you are preparing the crystal of NaCl and you mix the strontium chloride as impurity, then what will happen? Every Sr2 plus is having two plus charge, and Na is having plus one charge. So to maintain the electrical neutrality, every Sr2 plus ion will displace two Na plus ion. Out of two position, one position is accommodated by this strontium and one position become vacant. Clear? So by this means the vacancy, cationic vacancy created there. Okay, so as much the number of Sr2 plus ions are there, the same number of cationic vacancy will be there. So this is the answer of this question. Now question number 1.22, ionic solids which have an ionic vacancy due to metal excess defect. So develop color, explain with the help of a suitable example. So the question is, whenever there is a metal excess defect in the ionic solid and it is due to an ionic vacancy, it develop color. So it is because of F center. The answer of this question, it is because of F center. And the example is NaCl, which has a yellow color. And the discussion of this F center is in this topic, when over the crystal of NaCl you are spreading the fresh sodium vapor, then the chloride ion will move to the top of the crystal and react with the fresh sodium. Then sodium will release one electron, and that electron will occupy the position of that anion which has left its place. And this is the vacancy. This is the vacancy which is created by Cl minus, and this vacancy is filled by the electron which is lost by the sodium. So this is termed as F center, where F center, from the German word, it is Farbenzentrum, means color center, and this free electron is responsible for the color of that particular crystal. Because when you are following the light or electromagnetic radiation over the crystal, this electron get excited, and when it coming back to its ground state, it emits certain radiation. For example, in the case of NaCl, it will show the yellow color. In the case of LiCl, it will show pink color. In the case of potassium chloride, it will show violet color. Like this, there is the color. Now the next one, a group 14 element is to be converted into n-type semiconductor by doping. Is it with a suitable impurity? So the doping is the process by which you are adding an impurity to the intrinsic semiconductor to make them either n-type or p-type, or collectively they are termed as extrinsic semiconductor. So n-type semiconductor means those semiconductor in which electrons are the carrier, means negative charges are the carrier, so the electrons are the carrier, and electrons become the carrier when the impurity is having one more electron than the corresponding particular number of electrons present in that particular semiconductor. So if 14 group element is the semiconductor, it means it has 4 electrons in the outermost shell, then you have to add a 15 group element as impurity, because 15 group element is having 5 electrons in the outermost shell. Out of 5, 4 is used in the bond formation with the silicon or the germanium, and 1 electron become free, which is responsible for the conductivity. Okay, so the answer is 15 group. Now 24th question, what type of substances would make better permanent magnet, ferromagnetic or ferrimagnetic? Justify your answer. Obviously ferromagnetic substances will make the more better permanent magnet, because ferromagnetic substances are those substances or those magnets in which the domains are arranged in a parallel direction, and when the external source of magnetic field is removed, it will remain in the permanent direction. That's why it form a permanent magnet. So this is all about the in-text question present in this chapter. So if you understood all the questions very clearly, in my next video I will discuss the questions of exercise. So if you like this video, kindly like, share and subscribe. Thank you.